Hey, everyone. It's Chuck Daly with Infectious Diseases, and I have the great honor today of introducing today's Grand Round speaker. That is Monica Gandhi. Monica is professor of medicine in the Division of HIV Infectious Disease and Global Medicine at UCSF. She is medical director of the of what I finally recall is Ward 86, which is the HIV clinic. She's associate division chief of ID. She's director of the Center for AIDS Research. And actually, we don't have time to go through all the other things she somehow impossibly gets done. Just very quickly, I don't want to take too much of your time, but I just find it interesting that you began your professional career in a neighboring state, which is Utah. Where she got her undergraduate degree at the University of Utah, where her father was a former chair of engineering. From there, she had a stint in Cambridge, Harvard Medical School, and where we met at UCSF, where she did her residency fellowship and has now been an incredibly active and productive member of the faculty. To be honest, she has two numerous account R01s and grants. I mean, I quit counting, over 200 publications in high impact journals. And if anybody has been paying any attention to both the lay press, social media, New England Journal about COVID, you see Monica's name over and over again. So we welcome you today to share your insights into the COVID vaccine, something that you've been very active in. But before I finish, I do want to just a personal note, which is I was an attending when Monica was a resident, and I remember her very well. And there are three things that stand out. One, super smart. Number two, super inquisitive, always asking questions. And number three, you see it right now. She was always smiling, no matter how crazy San Francisco General was. That was one thing I could count on. So, Monica, please, we welcome you.
Thank you so much. It's such an honor to be introduced by you, Dr. Daly. I'm sorry you were my attending. I can't call you Chuck. it was wonderful to be taught by you, and we miss you every day. Okay, so I will start, and you know, I'm going to leave plenty of time for questions, but I wanted to talk about basically the vaccines in the time of Delta, because here we are thinking things were getting better and they still are going to, but certainly we had more difficulty than we thought because of the Delta variant. So just to start, you know, I do think it's sort of profound at this stage of the pandemic to recognize that we have 9 vaccines for COVID-19. We have 3 that are either authorized or approved, which is Pfizer in this country, but we have 9 vaccines around the world that are approved for COVID in some way or the other. They mostly have peer-reviewed publications. We're still waiting for that for Johnson & Johnson, actually. And it is a profound time for this to have occurred so quickly. To remind ourselves, the majority, or at least 6 out of those 9, involve in some way the spike protein. So they involve this piece of the COVID-19 virus, SARS-CoV-2, that sticks out and sticks to the host cells via the receptor binding protein. And 6 out of 9 either code for or actually give the spike protein of the SARS-CoV-2 virus. 3 out of those 9, Sinovac, Sinopharm, and the pharmaceuticals product in India, the Covaxin product, are whole inactivated variants. And of the 6 that involve the spike protein in some way, 2 of them involve quite novel technology, which is the mRNA technology. So Pfizer and Moderna, of course, give the genetic material, the mRNA that codes for the spike protein surrounded by this lipid bilayer. And then you take that mRNA and you translate it into protein, and then you raise an immune response against that spike protein. Though adenovirus DNA technology has been used before, it's not that common either. Ebola is not a common infection, for example. So it really isn't a very common technology, but three out of them, the Johnson & Johnson, the Sputnik V, and the AstraZeneca vaccines involve the DNA that codes for the spike protein with an adenovirus vector that brings it into your body. And then, of course, DNA gets made into mRNA, and then the same process occurs that you make the spike protein and raise an immune response. And then the Novavax product is the most traditional of all vaccines, giving a protein, which is the spike protein in this case, linked with an adjuvant. And then the three inactivated ones are the Sinovac, Sinopharm, and Covaxin. Now, I had to remind us of the immune system, especially now, actually, while we're talking about waning immunity, because it's really behooves us to remember our immunology and why we're seeing some antibody changes, but not necessarily waning immunity across all arms of the immune system. Of course, to remember, B cells really make antibodies, and antibodies will wane with time. Totally natural. If we had antibodies in our bloodstream from every infection vaccine we'd ever seen, we wouldn't be able to move because our bloodstream would be so thick. And really what the memory B cells are there for are to produce more antibodies when and if we see the virus again. And then T cells, of course, are the major immune defense against viruses. We know that with those of us who study HIV, and CD4 cells are the T helper cells. We want a TH1 response for viruses more than a TH2, and then cytotoxic T cells. And so the reason I remind us of this is because it's really the T cells in our immune response that protect us against severe disease. Multiple studies show this. And really, not only from multiple areas around the country, but Nadia Rohn here at the Gladstone at UCSF has done a lot of research around this, but really those who get more asymptomatic or mild disease had a really functional T cell response to SARS-CoV-2 even prior to vaccination, but it really is the T cells that are preventing us from getting severe disease. And the reason that's so important to remind ourselves is that all these vaccine trials did something that, you know, we had never done with vaccine trials before, which was to take the time and the trouble to measure T cell responses to vaccination in their phase 1/2 clinical trials. So Moderna, Pfizer, Johnson & Johnson being the ones in our country. Of course, the Johnson & Johnson is that adenovirus DNA, and it's one dose right now, and the other are two doses. But they produce both in the phase 1 trials, both neutralizing antibodies and produce strong TH1 CD4 cell responses and CD8 cell responses, and also, of course, protected macaques from rechallenge. So it really, every single trial down Sputnik V, looked at T cell responses, not just neutralizing antibody responses in their phase 1/2 trials. And they were studied in large placebo versus vaccine clinical phase 3 clinical trials. And this yellow column in column 6 is quite telling and sort of talking a lot about what's going on now, is that there was an incredible protection against severe disease, or at least hospitalizations and deaths due to COVID. In fact, actually, at least across the clinical trials, almost 100% of those who were hospitalized with COVID or died from COVID were in the placebo arm. There was almost 100% protection from those terrible outcomes if you got the vaccine. And then the variability really occurred, likely because of antibody responses, when there were variants. The variability of the efficacy of the vaccines in the phase 3 clinical trials really occurred across variants, which we're going to talk about later when we talk about B cells. So even the three inactivated whole viral candidates that all have peer-reviewed publications actually prevented 100% of severe disease. So, and where are we, by the way, in terms of adolescents and children? Well, we only have the Pfizer vaccine that is authorized, not approved, for 12 to 15 year olds. This was the New England Journal study that randomized half of adolescents to getting the vaccine and half to getting placebo. It was pretty small, 2,260 total. And there were only 16 cases of symptomatic COVID, but they all were in the placebo arm. again, the antibody response was very strong, but the reason it's still under EUA, even though the Pfizer vaccine was just approved this last Monday for adults, is because the EUA was only authorized, emergency use authorization, on May 10th, and the FDA really wants longer follow-up of the adolescents in this trial and real world data from adolescents getting vaccinated to ensure that there are no major safety concerns before fully approving it. And of course, it was 5 months behind the adult EUA, which was December 14th, 2020 for the Pfizer vaccine. So this is, of course, that statement on August 23rd that the Pfizer vaccine has been fully approved, not in 12 to 15 year olds, but in 16 and older, and is called Comirnaty. Okay, so the reason that there was concern and requires a longer follow-up for the younger patients is participants in the trials is that there was a concern raised specifically about young males after the second dose of myocarditis. Luckily, these cases of myocarditis are mild, as summarized by this MMWR article, and really seem to respond well to aspirin or colchicine, but given the lower risk of infection in younger people, further follow-up is not only necessary, I think it will give more confidence in the vaccine by parents. And then finally, that same confidence in the vaccine for the younger children hopefully will be bolstered by the fact that the FDA asked both Pfizer and Moderna to expand the participant pool for children 5 to 11. They were originally only going to look at 2,200 participants, just like the 12 to 15 year old trial, and they asked them to increase it to 5,000 so that we could detect any safety concerns. And that has led to a slight delay in the 5 to 11 year olds, even though the Pfizer CEO says that hopefully the 5 to 11 year old data will be ready in September. And also importantly, because of the myocarditis concerns, the dose for younger children, 5 to 11, was decreased. And now they're looking at 10 micrograms for children and 5 micrograms for even younger children, 5 and younger. And remember, the dose is a 30 microgram dose for adults or even those over 12. So, will vaccines work against variants and against severe disease? Well, the answer there is yes, because of the T cells, but the variability is going to occur because of B cells and antibodies, which we'll talk about next. But if we remain on the topic of T cells, the best way to explain it against these variants, and of course, Alpha was the one in this country starting from about March and dominated until we got to, we didn't really have a beta gamma variant issue here, but really dominated until the Delta variant hit our shores and really, really now are over 95% of our strains here over the last month and a half or almost more than 7 weeks. And the Delta variant was first seen in India in early March during their incredibly terrible and deadly second wave. That was hit India at a time where there was 4% of the population was vaccinated, which was very different than when it hit us, or at least hit areas in our country that were more highly vaccinated. And there's variability around our country of more highly vaccinated and lower vaccinated regions in terms of how much we're seeing with the Delta variant. But in terms of the T cell response against the Delta variant, the best way to explain that really, and this is really great data that is generated a lot by the La Jolla Immunology Institute, but from all over the country, about how robust and in breadth the T cell repertoire is across the entire virus, but specifically across the spike protein. And at least there are 87, at least 8 epitopes across the spike protein that different T cells respond to. And so if we think about the Delta variant in particular, it has 13 mutations along the spike protein. So you have, this 87, you may knock out 13 of those epitopes, but you still have 75 T cells that line up across the spike protein, even with the Delta variant. So it really is going to be hard for me to imagine a time that we could get a variant that would evade at least our T-cell immunity, given how robust and in-breadth our T-cell response is across the spike protein. And that really has been shown in multiple studies, even with the Delta variant, that the T-cell response generated by the vaccines and generated by natural infection is retained and is really high and in-breadth across, and is basically intact, completely intact against the variants. And this has been shown, of course, in different studies. The South Africa trial, unfortunately, did stop the AstraZeneca trial in South Africa because it was not protecting against mild or moderate disease as well. But severe disease, when they went back to looked on May 20th, was covered by, again, the T-cell response. And that's because in that particular case, the Gamma variant, which used to be called the South Africa variant, did knock out of those 87 T-cell epitopes, it did knock out 13, but you still had 75 epitopes that were in intact across that, actually 12, so knocked out 12. So we still had 75 epitopes, T cells that covered the spike protein. So it did protect against severe disease. And unfortunately, South Africa, as a result of this trial, turned away the AstraZeneca vaccine. And then when the wave really hit South Africa, they didn't have AstraZeneca supply to protect against at least severe disease. So that T cell response is real vigorous, active, and is what's leading to what we're seeing now in this country with the Delta. Interestingly, what we're seeing now with the Delta variant in this country, of course, is I put the slide in the wrong place, but sorry, that there are two CDC studies that were published just a couple of days ago, one from LA and one from New York. And in New York, definitely looks like we have waning efficacy against more mild disease, but over 90% effectiveness against severe disease with our vaccines. And then the LA study showed that there is a 29 times more likelihood that you'd be in the hospital if you are unvaccinated and eligible than if you are vaccinated. So that hospitalization rate being, you know, 1/29th of those who are vaccinated really speaks to the power of these vaccines, enduring power, even in the face of the Delta variant, to protect us against hospitalizations. Interestingly, the effectiveness does seem higher in the UK and Canada, even against mild disease. The UK data is really showing us up to 80% effectiveness, even against mild disease, again, 96% protection against severe disease. And Canada data is showing 88% protection against mild disease, 96% against severe disease. I think that's actually a function of the fact that the UK and Canada gave their doses with longer durations between them. We chose a 3-week strategy for the Pfizer vaccine that was studied in the clinical trials in Israel and the US, but UK and Canada space out their doses and to get people protected against severe disease sooner, actually chose a 12-to-8-week strategy between doses. We'll talk about that more in a minute. So are vaccines waning in effectiveness with Delta? They are against more mild disease. And that really is, I think, a function of the B cells versus the T cells. So when we think about vaccine effectiveness, this is courtesy of Mugay-Sevik, it's really important to remember that it's not as simple as just saying we're seeing a lot of mild symptomatic breakthroughs, because it really depends on where you are. It depends on demographic factors. It depends if you have high rates of circulating virus in your community versus Vermont where you don't. It depends on if you're next to someone who has COVID in your household. It depends on who you are as a host in terms of being older age, being immunocompromised, having previous infection, which would defend you more, or underlying health conditions. And it depends on what vaccine you got. A Pfizer vaccine with 3 weeks between doses may not actually be as effective as a Moderna vaccine with 4 weeks between doses, which I'll talk about in a minute. It depends on immune factors of you, your T cells, your antibody titers, and then also the viral variant is only one of these factors that go into to vaccine effectiveness in the middle of an ongoing pandemic. So I think we're simplifying when we make broad statements about vaccine effectiveness right now without thinking about some of these factors. as I told you, really what is remaining persistent is our protection against severe disease. The lowest was one study out of the US that showed 80% effectiveness against severe disease in the Mayo Clinic system. That was the lowest. Actually, everyone else, and I'll talk about that in a minute, but everyone else, Qatar, England, Canada, which is not on the slide, has shown very high and persistent effectiveness levels, about 90 to 96% protection against severe disease, even with the Delta variant. And this is actually in Israel as well, with protection against severe disease, as shown in the second column in July 17th. But where there is widely ranging effectiveness estimates are in protection against symptomatic or mild disease, mild symptomatic breakthroughs. UK and Canada, it depends on the study. Again, the biggest study out of the US is the New York MMWR study published just 2 days ago that looks like we've gone down to 80% protection. Is in Canada, 88% protection against symptomatic disease. And then there's this outlier study, which is 40% protection in Israel against symptomatic disease. The reason I call that an outlier study is it's not consistent with this other data, but beyond that, we haven't yet seen the methods and the full not even peer reviewed. We haven't even seen a preprint of that data. So that is data that we're still waiting to see better estimate of and better methods before we use the word 40% in general. However, I think there's no doubt, even anecdotally, even in these studies, that there's more symptomatic breakthrough infections with Delta than we saw with Alpha. And I do think it could be possibly because of higher viral load, which we know we see with Delta. I actually think it's more a function of just a deeper understanding of the immune system. And I think that we do have to recognize that antibodies wane over time, that people got their vaccines, healthcare workers and people in long-term care facilities as early as January. It's now end of August. And that the way that we administered the vaccines likely had something, a lot to do with the initial antibody response. So it's just well known in vaccinology. I think Dr. Stanley Plotkin wrote a really nice CID article in January urging the US to give a longer duration between doses, not just because of getting more people protected sooner so that we could save lives, but really because of in any other kind of field, hepatitis B is a very good example where we give the first and third vaccine 6 months apart, because increasing duration between doses lead to higher antibodies. And that has been shown in a Nature paper with the Pfizer vaccine in the UK, that they chose 12 weeks between doses, and that actually led to a much higher antibody response than the choosing of 3 weeks between doses, which is again how Pfizer studied it, but they were in a hurry and not usually how vaccinology is done. There's no other vaccine that's given every 3 weeks. And Canada also adopted that strategy. When they got the Delta, they went to 8 weeks, but we see fewer symptomatic breakthroughs in those two countries. There was a big Mayo Clinic study, this is in preprint down here at the bottom, that was also just recent, a week ago, that showed there's less reinfection across the Mayo Clinic system with the Moderna vaccine than the Pfizer vaccine. And in the discussion of that paper, they cite not only that Moderna has a higher dose, it's 100 micrograms versus Pfizer, which is 30 micrograms of the mRNA, but also that Moderna is given at 4 weeks versus 3 weeks. And even that 1 week more may increase our antibodies more. And so it's normal. Waning antibodies occur with time. It's not a glitch. We usually don't roll out vaccines in the middle of a pandemic. 1918 pandemic, we got through it, unfortunately, after 50 million deaths with natural immunity. And the 1942 was the first influenza vaccine that we ever had. So we're not usually rolling out these vaccines in the middle of a pandemic, but antibodies are waning, antibodies are normal, and they will be made anew by memory B cells if they see the virus again. That is what memory B cells do. This is a very simple example of that, of course. A first time when a virus attacks a body, you will see antibodies go up. They will, of course, come down. That's normal. That's natural. And then what happens is if you see the virus again, you will actually get a stronger antibody response. the amazing thing about this virus, but it's actually not that peculiar to this virus, is that we have very nice papers, one from OHSU, one from the University of Pennsylvania, that show us that when memory B cells make antibodies again, if they see the if they see a virus again, they will make them adapted towards the variants. They will not make antibodies that are against the Wuhan ancestral strain. They will make antibodies that are directed against the Delta variant, because that's what memory B cells are. They're blueprints, and they will modify their antibodies that come out to adapt to and evolve towards whatever they see. So the spike protein antibodies will be adapted towards the variants. So who needs an additional COVID vaccine? It seems to be a very big question of the day this week. And currently the CDC is recommending that moderately to severe immunocompromised people receive an additional dose. That completely makes sense, at least in terms of what we've ever done with vaccinology, with giving people who are older higher doses of influenza vaccine every year, giving people additional vaccine shots when they're immunocompromised. And so these are the criteria: cancer treatment or organ transplant or stem cell transplant, or having a primary immunodeficiency or advanced HIV, or active treatment with immunosuppressive drugs. And because that advanced HIV was left somewhat vague, our recommendations at Ward 86 are anyone who has a CD4 count less than 200, who are virologically non-suppressed, or based on provider judgment, essentially. If they had had a history of AIDS in the past or OIs in the past, or is someone that even has a good immune reconstitution, but is still more susceptible to, for example, multiple respiratory infections or multiple herpes DNA infections, lots of shingles. Those are the patients that we're giving third shots to. The question, if everyone needs a booster, if they're immunocompetent, I am going to leave to this audience to decide. I will say, for those like Dr. Daly and others who have worked globally, it is hard to contemplate a time of greater vaccine inequity than we have right now. Right now in this world, 2% of vaccine doses have been given out in low-income countries. This is actually data that's updated very regularly. And we got up from 1% and now we're at 2%. So you're 50 times more likely to have received a vaccine than if you're in a high-income country than a low-income country. This feels very much like the rollout of antiretroviral therapy and how unfair it was. And beyond that, there are healthcare workers who are our fellow healthcare workers who are truly dying of COVID-19 because they haven't had access to a shot in areas of sub-Saharan Africa that you can see is all white here. That's how low our rates of vaccine access are in these countries. And we are contemplating giving boosters to 20-year-olds in this country as early as September 20th. So I think I've given my answer with what I think about it, but I'll leave it up to the audience. Okay, so do vaccines reduce transmission? The answer is actually yes, but with Delta less so. Not completely wiped out with Delta, but less so. So why do vaccines reduce transmission? I mean, they always reduce transmission because that's what antibodies do. So IgA, of course, is the mucosal immunoglobulin, and they are induced by the COVID-19 vaccines. We have a lot of data on that. Also go into breast milk, for example, and are along mucosal surfaces, IgA induced by the vaccines. And then IgG, which is induced by the vaccines, also go into the nasal mucosa. That's well known for antibodies as well. But again, these antibodies are waning over time as we're getting into the Delta variant wave. And so really saw incredible reductions in asymptomatic infection and in mild symptomatic. There weren't really a lot of mild symptomatic breakthroughs. These really look like a force field prior to the Delta variant, these vaccines. This is just multiple studies from around the world that looked at asymptomatic infection, like when healthcare workers or Mayo Clinic patients were swabbed routinely after vaccination, just to ensure that they weren't getting asymptomatic colonization or infection in their nose. And in the largest study, the reduction was 94% of even getting any ability for you to carry it in your nose prior to the Delta variant. What we're seeing with the Delta variant is something different. Again, I think it could also be temporally related with the time since we've gotten our vaccines and waning antibodies. But I think the message that vaccinated people are equally likely to spread as unvaccinated is not biologically sound. And I think that was not the message the CDC should have given on July 27th. So what the CDC did on July 27th was allude to the Provincetown outbreak data that they didn't release for 4 days. And it was a very confusing week. And then the Provincetown outbreak study was shown in the MMWR. And this was really a mixed group of vaccinated and unvaccinated, mostly gay men who go to Provincetown for a very fun week, routinely every year, and came this year as well. Even though Provincetown was highly vaccinated, it was more of a mixed visitor group. And there was a lot of symptomatic breakthroughs. Now, that was kind of a stress test to the vaccines. There was happened to be raining that week, a lot of inside activity, no masks. They weren't recommended for vaccinated people. Windows were closed because it was raining, and a lot of intimacy. And all of that put together led to a high rate of symptomatic breakthroughs, but it was a massive amount of exposure. And I think it was an incredible stress test for the vaccines that how few people got symptomatic disease. There were 3 people who were vaccinated who went into the hospital and came out very quickly. So very little severe disease in those who were vaccinated. Again, speaking to our T cell immunity. However, the CDC messaged, unfortunately, from a single cycle threshold value, the PCR test. Remember what that means. The PCR test has to go through multiple cycles to trigger a positive test with a PCR test on a for SARS-CoV-2. And if you have to go through many cycles, like over a 25, you have a very low viral load. It takes a lot to cycle to get to that that positive test. And so that means you have a low viral load. And at one point in time in the Provincetown outbreak, just at a single cross-sectional time, vaccinated breakthroughs seemed to have the same CT value that was about 19 to 20, so it was lower than 25. We think it's infectious at a single point in time. But just the next day, this Singapore study was released, which showed a Delta variant outbreak in Singapore. And as you would expect, if you do serial viral load testing, or at least serial PCR testing, and then estimated your viral load from the CT value of the PCR test, the viral load came down more quickly, and those who are vaccinated, that's the green line, and those who are unvaccinated. Totally makes sense. You have an immune response. You have adaptive immunity. It will take your memory B cells a couple of days, 3 to 4 days, to produce the antibodies to get into that nose, bring it down, and you also have T cell immunity in your nose. So all of that means that if we did serial testing in that Provincetown outbreak, hopefully the viral loads would have dropped more quickly among the vaccinated. Again, doesn't mean that you can't spread if you are a symptomatic breakthrough, but I think the idea that you're equally likely to spread is not true, doesn't make sense microbiologically. And then here's a nice study from the Netherlands just from a couple of days ago that showed us that among 161 breakthrough infections with Delta in healthcare workers, and this was among 22,000 healthcare workers, these breakthrough infections that if you culture the virus, which of course is taking it a step further, does takes extra work, that the virus was less likely to be infectious by culture in a vaccinated symptomatic breakthrough. Totally makes sense. Again, your immune response should be coming in and really hobbling and trying to hurt that virus and make it less infectious. So bottom line, I think you can spread if you're symptomatic, but I think you're less likely to spread than if you're unvaccinated, which is why I think trying to bring down transmission with vaccines among the fully vaccinated, as opposed to getting the unvaccinated vaccinated, may not be our best strategy. In terms of your ability to spread if you're asymptomatic and vaccinated, we would need really good contact tracing studies. We didn't think that you could spread if you were asymptomatic and vaccinated before Delta. And based on all that data, which is why the CDC on May 13th took off masks for vaccinated people. This is the best that we can come up with. This is a Singapore, but they haven't put it into a peer-reviewed publication yet, but they have this case cluster analysis that if you actually go to this website and select vaccinated and asymptomatic, you can't see that cases are connected to those, at least in contact tracing, to those who are asymptomatic and vaccinated. So I think being asymptomatic and vaccinated is probably a very low risk for spread, even with the Delta variant. This was up to June 28th, so the Delta variant was in Singapore, but we'll need more data on that. The CDC strategy for monitoring breakthroughs is still not, and I think that's indicated based on what I just said from that Singapore study, if you're not exposed, not screening if you're asymptomatic after vaccination, but if you're, what they did change with Delta variant is screening if you're exposed after being asymptomatic after vaccination. And then if you're symptomatic after vaccination, CDC is asking the states to monitor, and monitoring in these cohorts, like the New York study that I told you about and in the LA study. But they are only monitoring severe breakthrough infections. And this is the latest data. Actually, it was just updated this morning, but I didn't have a chance. We're up now up to 171 million Americans who are fully vaccinated. But this was just from yesterday, that out of 168 million Americans who are fully vaccinated against COVID-19, there have been 6,059 hospitalized breakthroughs. So that is the percentage is 0.003% or four zeros and three. Those are the, that's the number of those who have severe breakthrough infections. So it's remaining low, even with Delta, because getting a severe breakthrough infection, the vaccines are really providing good protection against severe infections. And then the death rate is 6 in a million. So dying from COVID after you've been fully vaccinated is also rare. Now, I think what the CDC should do is take these 6,059 people, give us their demographics, stratify them, say how many are immunocompromised, say how many are over 70, say how many are over 60, and they could make the decision about third shots based on that stratified data or that demographic data of those who are at risk for severe breakthrough in our country. I think that would be a helpful way to decide on third boosters right now. And then this was supposed to be somewhere else. Sorry, but these are the, this is the Los Angeles County data that they just published. It says tomorrow, well, it says today, which is the 27th, but it was, there was a preprint, there was a, it was pre-released a couple of days ago, that showed again, your 20, the rate of hospitalization, if you're unvaccinated eligible, is 29.2 times that if you're vaccinated. So really keeping that high level of protection against severe disease, though there are definitely more mild symptomatic breakthroughs. And then in terms of how long our immune response is going to last, I wanted to give you some, a reminder of what memory B cells and memory T cells do in terms of how long they last, at least from other infections. So this is a study I love, that about memory B cells. So there was a study that was published in Nature in 2008 that happened to find, well, they took the trouble to find almost 35 people around, 35 people who had, who were now between the ages of 90 and 101, but they had all been around 3 to 10 years old in 1918, and they had all been infected with influenza. So they had all survived the 1918 influenza pandemic. And about 90 to 100 years later, they took these very elderly people, and they saw that they had strong memory B cells still circulating in their bloodstream that worked against the 1918 strain of influenza. They took out their blood, they put it into a test tube with the influenza strain from 1918. Those memory B cells were able to form strong neutralizing antibodies. Then they took those neutralizing antibodies, put them in mice, and they protected them from the influenza strain from 1918. So if your memory B cells can last 90 years, and we know that we get memory B cells from these vaccines, because there's been not only multiple studies that show that in the bloodstream, but there's also been studies that have biopsied lymph nodes of people who've gotten the mRNA vaccines, and also biopsied bone marrow of those who've had natural infection, and found really strong concentration and increasing concentration of memory B cells being formed in the lymph nodes and the bone marrow. And so they actually did serial. So seeing that strong concentration of memory B cells, and knowing how long your ability to produce neutralizing antibodies are, and knowing that those antibodies will be adapted towards certain variants if they see the variants in the future, gives me a lot of confidence about these vaccines. Memory T cells, of course, are generated by natural infection and the vaccines. And those we already knew were long-lasting. Measles vaccines, there's a study that T cells last 34 years and counting. And then also importantly, memory T cells from the SARS pandemic, which was late 2002 and 2003, there was a Nature 2020 study that showed us that 17 years later, people who had survived the SARS pandemic in 2003 still had strong T cell immunity. So really, T cell immunity lasts a long time. Antibodies don't. That's known. It's not a glitch of the immune system. It's what happens. But our memory B cells can produce antibodies many, many years later. And then if we could just get transmission down worldwide, which we're not doing a good job of because we're not, we're staying nationalistic in our approach. All the G7 countries are, and they are hoarding a lot of these vaccines. But if we could keep transmission down worldwide, the virus will ultimately not mutate like this. It isn't influenza. It isn't HIV. It actually has quite a fastidious polymerase, the coronaviruses do, and they are not going to mutate at high rates like influenza does or like HIV does. In fact, it's an RNA virus, but one paper called it a DNA virus wannabe, because that's how strong the proofreading mechanism is. So getting transmission down worldwide is really of paramount importance to prevent emergence of future variants. So why do I think vaccines will work against the variants? I really want to just summarize that if your memory B cells see the virus in the future, you'll produce antibodies directed against those variants. You'll also get an immune boost. And memory T cells are so complex and so in breadth that they form across the whole spike protein and variants. I doubt you could get a variant that has 100 mutations across the spike protein. Usually evolutionary biology constrains the ability of a virus to mutate that much. So I will actually end there and see what questions you have. And I hope I've reassured you about the power of our immune system. And it really was, it's really been an amazing thing to see that we got these vaccines out so quickly. And it's really been, I see that as an incredible, incredible feat of technology. So I will stop there.
Thank you, Monica. Excellent. Fantastic. You generated many questions, so that's a good talk. So let's see if we can get through or how many of these we can get through. I'm going to start with the ones that came in through the Q&A. One of the questions, there are actually two questions that relate to Lambda. One was, how will Lambda and future variants impact progress forward if we're able to even forecast such a thing? And then related to Lambda are the changes in the spike protein with the Lambda variant particularly worrisome?
So it's a great question. So one thing is that the Lambda variant, though it's been around quite some time, has in no way been able to dominate the Delta variant, because the Delta variant is likely one of the most transmissible respiratory viruses we've seen. That's, by the way, very evolutionarily smart of this virus to develop an ability to become more and more transmissible. That's sort of evolutionarily sound. And so Delta plus Lambda, none of these have been able to make a dent on Delta in terms of the predominance of these variants worldwide. So I actually think they are not going to become a problem. We need to get over the Delta surge, and I'm not as worried about these. I know Lambda got a reputation for being more immune evasive. Again, that's such a simplification from not looking at T cell immunity versus antibody response, which I still find myself surprised by. The media and even scientists are only talking about antibodies when, you know, I mean, we all know that the T cell response is real. It's not a hoax. The Lambda variant cannot resist T cell immunity. It does look like the antibodies are lower though against the Lambda variant. So if it ever became predominant somewhere, maybe you will need another shot to increase your antibodies, but your T cell immunity is still preserved. Think of those 100 T cells. Think of it that way, lining up across the spike protein. I don't think we're going to ever get a variant that can evade T cell immunity.
Okay. I think I'll sleep better tonight. The next question relates to children, and it says, what's the rationale for vaccinating children and young adults considering their very low probability of a severe disease?
That's accurate. They are much, much lower risk for severe disease. It really is a blessing. However, at high rates of transmission, so for example, in Arkansas, Louisiana, Mississippi now, just with so much transmission around, there are more children in the hospital than there are in San Francisco, where we actually have zero as of a week ago, where there were more highly vaccinated. So when a case is really, when an infection is very highly prevalent, then anyone who has even some immunocompromised or some compromising condition, because those are the more children who are affected, who are more immunocompromised, they're just more likely to get around it. And that makes me worried about children not being vaccinated. The second reason is to reduce transmission to older people. And it's not like we haven't done that in the if you think about childhood vaccination programs, measles, mumps, rubella, diphtheria, pertussis are all infections that affect children more, and they are mandated in schools. But actually, so is pneumococcal vaccine. Not really so much for children or for like a 12-year-old, for example, but for older people. And it's something that if a vaccine is safe, that we have done to protect older people, to protect multi-generational households, to protect immunocompromised, and to protect others. So I think that all put together is the rationale for vaccinating children and young adults. It will decrease transmission as well. One thing I will say, that safety is paramount, and we should never underplay safety concerns with vaccines and our parents' concerns of vaccine concerns. We should never underplay them. And I think it's important that the FDA said, expand the trials, give us more participants so that we can look for safety.
Okay, thank you. There's definitely some support for your point about the vaccination globally and the inequity that exists. I can see that from a couple of our faculty here. Yes. One is that, I'll just read it, says, I totally agree that we need to have better equity towards the world. However, if our kids keep getting hospitalized more, then isn't there a way to prevent their infection to all to have a booster vaccine?
So that is actually a great question. And the question is, will we bring down transmission more quickly if we boost everyone? I think we will some, because I just said that symptomatic breakthroughs can transmit, though I think they're less likely to transmit. I think we all know that the best thing we could do in this country, however, is get unvaccinated adults vaccinated, because that's what's kept children safe prior with the Alpha variant, or even in states like my own or my city, which has high rates of vaccination, where children aren't being hospitalized like they are in Louisiana and Mississippi and Arkansas. So getting the unvaccinated vaccinated, if we could put that as our first priority, at least, and then and anything that it takes, right? And I think we all know that it's anywhere from compassionate education to mandates, which are increasingly coming up, vaccine passports and mandates, which are not only increasingly coming up, but increasingly endorsed after the Pfizer vaccine was fully approved. So that being our main focus, then our second focus with boosters, I will say that, again, when I think about boosters, I still think more about the people who are more at risk factor for severe breakthroughs, but I'm also not making the decisions in this country either. And it's coming. I mean, third boosters will come. Like, I don't think the Biden administration is going to change their mind on this. And I also don't think they're going to give shots more to the rest of the world. I think Trump, if he had done that, would have been accused of quite a bit. And we're being more nationalistic than I thought we'd be. But I think it's going to happen. And if I were making these decisions for this country, I would say I can see the advantages. And I'm wondering if we should focus on certain age groups, even over 50, or parents, for example. But you know what? It's very complicated, and I can't say I know all the answers either.
Okay. Some other themes here. So why in the U.S. are previously COVID-infected subjects advised to get a vaccine?
Well, I have to say that that's a very good question. And I am not going to say the answer that is politically correct. And I'm just going to say it. So in other places, the infected people are advised to either not get vaccinated or get a single shot of the vaccine. Israel, France, Spain, Germany, single shot, or they will even recognize immunity passports, and they will actually hold, you can go into a restaurant with a vaccine passport or with an immunity passport. Germany is no slouch, like they know what they're doing immunologically. Israel just had a preprint just this week, which got quite a bit of attention. It was summarized in Science this morning, that showed that reinfection rates were actually more common after vaccination in Israel than they are after natural infection. And that natural infection is more protective than the Pfizer vaccine, which again, Israel only has the Pfizer vaccine. I think we have more protection in this country with our mixture of vaccines, and the UK has even more protection with their more AstraZeneca. But the Pfizer vaccine given every 3 weeks, I'm quite concerned about antibody waning with that. And Pfizer made a deal with Israel and they exclusively have Pfizer. So not recognizing natural immunity, I think will go down as policy failures, because it is creating distrust. It's not that natural immunity doesn't keep you safe from the coronavirus. I think we have quite a bit of data that shows this. There was a Kentucky study that was published notably by the CDC in the MMWR that said you're two times as likely to get reinfected in Kentucky if you've been previously infected than had the vaccine. There are limitations to that data. No one understood why they just chose one state when they had access to all the states of the CDC. No one understood why they used a case control design instead of prospective analysis, which is more susceptible to bias. There was a lot of criticisms of that study. So do I think you're protected if you've had natural infection? I do. What would I do if I had natural infection? I would get one dose. And why would I get one dose like Germany, Israel, Spain, France recommends? Because there is a really good data from our hospital that from Gladstone here that showed that you have better T cell maturation. I also think it'll give you an antibody boost during this time of high circulating rates of virus. And I would advise, if I were the CDC, I would say that if you're previously infected, give one dose. I think that would give more trust. Do I think that pharmaceutical companies have anything to do with not now acknowledging natural immunity? I have no idea, but that would be the cynical interpretation.
Okay, thank you. We have a question that relates to the data from the UK and Canada. So what is the vaccination rate in the UK and Canada? And if higher, could this explain the lower amount of breakthrough infections compared?
They had higher rates of immunity vaccination. They did a great job with their vaccination programs, not just because there was less vaccine hesitancy, but specifically giving one dose first, as many infectious disease doctors were urging of the United States. I think it was a very good idea, because it gave your T cells, so it actually saved lives. It protected people from severe disease during high amounts of circulating virus last winter. So there was less vaccine hesitancy. And basically the UK, when they fully opened on July 19th, which they haven't gone back from, and it's been almost, wow, it's been more than a month and they're fully open. They don't even have mask mandates indoors. They had a 76% first dose rate at that time. So they were at where like San Francisco was, and some of our cities in this country. Vermont overall had an 80% rate. So we really do have such variability around our country. As you know, there was a 30% rate of vaccination in Arkansas. So we are so variable. But yes, the UK and Canada had higher rates of vaccination, and overall have much fewer hospitalizations during the Delta surge than we do.
Okay, thank you. I think in the next 3 minutes, we have two questions that we'll try to get through. So how do we balance the better antibody response with increased time between doses, with a desire for people to get coverage more quickly with the effect of the two doses versus the one dose?
It's a great question. What happened in the UK when Delta hit is that they used to give 12 weeks between doses. And as soon as Delta happened, they said 8 weeks. We need to get our antibodies up. I think we could have come up with something like 6 weeks even, because we really needed our antibody. We really need those two doses for the Delta variant. But we stuck with 3 weeks throughout. I think kind of a nimble approach and changing things as things happen would have been better. I'm not sure if 6 weeks isn't more perfect, but it does seem like it's a good maybe compromise. But at this point, what's happening is that we are at a 3-week, and we're not going to change that in this country anyway. For those who are unvaccinated, where to give that third booster shot for the populations that need it, that's a debate that keeps on seeming to change every day. First, the U.S. said 8 months, then they said 6 months, they said 5 months. Again, longer time between doses. And I would urge you to read Stanley Plotkin's CID article from January 2021, increases your immune response.
Okay, so we're not going to get through all of these. We have some really good questions still, but let me just go to another group here. So would vaccinating unvaccinated individuals, I think they mean adults, be more protective than vaccinating kids, more protective of kids than vaccinating kids?
Yes, this really got shown even in the disparity around our country with what's happening with children at this moment during Delta surges. Again, we had zero, I think we may have 2 children in the hospital of all San Francisco. We had 0 last week in a highly vaccinated, again, children can't be vaccinated less than 12. It is all because we had high rates of adult vaccination. Adult vaccination, while we're waiting the children vaccine trials, protects children, no doubt. It's why I think teacher mandate for vaccines is very important.
Okay. I think that's a really important message to leave with, that we should be getting our adults vaccinated.
Yes, we should.
To try to get control of this. Monica, that was a fantastic talk. The discussion was fantastic as well.